was promised to go first to folks who call from outside North America and listening via Catholic.com. It's Peter. Is this the Peter I think it is in Brisbane?
Yes.
Welcome, Peter.
Good morning. Good morning from me. Good afternoon to you.
Good morning to you, Peter. I remember you fondly from our Catholic Answers cruise low these 3 or 4 years ago in the Mediterranean.
Yeah.
Good to hear from you, Peter. How can Jimmy help you tonight, but this morning where you are?
Right. Okay. I was researching one of my academic heroes, Isaac Newton,
mm-hmm.
and I found that he was a Unitarian,
mm-hmm.
and he wrote this paper called, wait for it, An Historical Account of Two Notable Corruptions in Scripture,
mm-hmm.
one of which he refers to is 1 John 5:7,
right,
which apparently has got the
Johannine comma.
Johannine comma.
Yeah.
You're familiar with it?
Yes, I am. Yeah.
My question is, what effect does that have on the modern theory of the Trinity? Because apparently people said this little piece was put in to bolster the theory of the Trinity, of which Isaac Newton, being a Unitarian, didn't agree with.
Right. First of all, we may want to explain the term Unitarian for folks who aren't familiar with it. Trinitarian is a person who believes that that there are three persons in the Godhead, that there is a tri-unity of persons. And so Trinitarianism is the Orthodox Christian position. Unitarianism is a variant position that holds that there's only one person in the Trinity. And there are different variations on Unitarianism. Sometimes it identifies the one person of the Trinity exclusively with God the Father, and would then say Jesus was not God, and the Holy Spirit was not God. Other times, in a form known as modalism or Sabellianism, the Unitarian position will be different. It will say all three, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, are all God, but they are only one person, and so they're like three different modes that one person occupies or operates in. And so that's why it's also sometimes called modalism. So my understanding is that Isaac Newton was the first kind of Unitarian, that he thought that God was God the Father, and therefore that Jesus was not God. Now, the passage you're referring to in John 5, 7 and 8 is known as the Johannine comma, and it's widely regarded by modern scholars as an instance of a copyist error. Before the days of the printing press, and even after the days of the printing press, but especially before the days of the printing press, when copies of Scripture had to be hand-duplicated, you'll find things in them where a scribe was asleep or, you know, sleepy, and he accidentally, as perhaps the text was being read out, he might have his mind wander for a minute and he'd miss something. Or you also find instances where what are known as glosses. Glosses were little comments that people would make in the margins of Scripture. Sometimes they would make them to correct a missing passage. If a scribe had accidentally left out some words, they would then, a later scribe would gloss that by putting in the needed words in the margin. And that posed a challenge for subsequent scribes, because how do they know what to do with this gloss? Do they put it back in the text? Is that what it's meant to do? Or is it just somebody's Bible study note? And so over the course of the centuries, that led to confusion. And in particular cases, scribes in certain scribal traditions would end up adding glosses into the text, and that seems to be what happened here. Someone had a marginal note that was not originally part of Scripture, and a later scribe thought it was a correction, and it was originally part of Scripture, and so he put it in his version, and then other people copied his version. Well, the good news is that because of the science of what's known as lower criticism or textual criticism, we can figure out when this has happened. And so scholars in subsequent centuries realized that, okay, the evidence suggests that the Johannine comma is not in the original. And so you won't find it in most Bibles today, except you may find a footnote just documenting its existence and explaining why it's not in the text. For those who have never heard of this before, basically the Johannine comma is an insertion, and the text goes like this. If you're reading along in John, 1 John 5:7, a typical Bible translation will start by saying, "For there are three that bear witness." And then in verse 8, it'll continue with the Spirit, the water, and the blood. So that's what we think the text originally said. But because of the gloss that got added in, it came to read for a time in many Bibles, "For there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. And there are three that bear witness on earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood." So you can see how there's been an insertion there that's a very explicit doctrine, statement of the doctrine of the Trinity. And for many years, people would use this as a proof text for the doctrine of the Trinity because it is so clear. But this has no ultimate bearing on the doctrine of the Trinity because the doctrine of the Trinity does not rest on this one verse. And so consequently, I never cite this when I'm proving the doctrine of the Trinity to somebody. I'll always go to other passages that document different aspects of the doctrine of the Trinity, and you put them together and you realize Trinitarianism has to be true. Mm-hmm. So even though this was for a time a popular proof text for the Trinity, it's by no means essential to the doctrine, and you can prove the doctrine from other verses and without this one altogether.
Peter in Brisbane, down under, thanks so much for the kind words, and enjoy your Catholic Answers cruise to the UK this summer. Glad to hear from you.